roll along here. Blessed be the one, holy and living God.
Lord God, forever and ever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open. All desires known and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Jeremiah. These are the words of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the remaining elders among the exiles, and to the priests, the prophets, and all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had given into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem, wives for your sons, and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters, multiply there, and do not decrease. But seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare. The word of the Lord. And let's do Psalm 66 responsibly by whole verse. Be joyful in God, all you lands. Sing the glory of his name. Sing the glory of his praise.
Sing to God, all you lands. Because of your great strength, your hand is stretched before you.
All the earth bows down before you, sings to you, sings out your name.
Come now, let's do your worst, God. How wonderful he is to live in all the world.
He turned the sea into dry land, so that they went through the water on foot, and there they rejoiced in him. Make the voice of his praise to be heard. For you, O God, have proved us. You have tried us just as silver is tried.
You brought us into the snare. You laid many burdens on our hearts.
You let enemies ride over our heads. We went through fire and water, but you brought us out into a place of refreshment.
Reading from the second letter of Paul to Timothy. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, a descendant of David. That is my gospel, for which I suffer hardship, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But the word of God is not chained. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, so that they may also obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is sure, if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Remind them of this, and warn them before God that they are to avoid wrangling over words, which does no good, but only ruins those who are listening. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved by him, a worker
Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. So I presume that many of you are knowledgeable about Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Yes? Some of you? Okay. It's that triangle, and it is the steps toward self-actualization. At the bottom is food, water, shelter, basic needs, right? And the second step is safety, feeling safe. The third step of the 5 is love and belonging. And that's what we're doing here today, is talking about belonging. Or not. So we have 2 stories of exile in our lessons. The first story from Jeremiah is about the Israelites who experienced the Exodus in approximately 1400 BC. So they've been through that slavery thing and through the Red Sea with Moses. Now, 800 years later, the Assyrians came and conquered Jerusalem, and they're in exile again. And they're like, "What is this?" They heard promises from a gentleman called Hananiah that it's just going to be a couple of years, it'll be okay. Well, then comes this message from Jeremiah. You know, old Jerry says, it's going to be like 70 years. And in your time of development, that's about 2 generations. So some of you that are hearing this today will not live to see freedom. So Jeremiah's message is, get on with living. Have families. Build houses, plant gardens, get married, have your children married, have grandchildren, and pray. They were in a land where there were multiple deities. But Jeremiah's instruction is pray to the God that you know and trust. And in Jesus' day, people afflicted with leprosy, or as we know it today, Hansen's disease, were exiled.
very contagious, which it really isn't. But people had to stay at 40 paces. Sometimes they put bells on them, and they had to shout out when they walked down the street, "Unclean," naming themselves as, "I'm the other, you can't come close to me." So their only way of living or belonging was with each other. And in this story today, there are 10 lepers, one of whom we learn is a Samaritan. So he's like double exile because he has leprosy and he's a foreigner. The Samaritans were not well respected. So my neighbor told me a story that's in a way related. Following World War II, American businesses were very busy establishing industry around the world. She told me the story of her father, who worked for Coca-Cola. And he traveled to multiple countries trying to establish the business, which we can see is now present. The company kept track of the various vaccinations that were required so that he stayed up to date. So at the airport in India, his documents were reviewed and he was not permitted to enter because of a vaccine issue. Neither was he allowed to return from whence he came. So he's kind of stuck. Well, then suddenly he was removed and taken to what they called a pest hut for people who were suspect of being infected. It was a primitive building with a dirt floor. They stuck a diaper on him and left him with the other inmates. Now, mind you, this is pre-cell phone, pre-internet, so there really wasn't great communication. So this guy is like locked up. For days, he remained, unable to communicate and with no knowledge of what was happening. He was stuck until the authorities of Coca-Cola and the Indian government agreed to release him. So can any of us imagine what a life of exile looks like? I suspect most of us can. Remember middle school? Everybody knows that, right? Some of you are in middle school, right? So you might know what exile is even today. So in today's world, in the media, I think about all those people displaced by Hurricane Ian. They're in a sort of exile. We hear stories of immigration, how people are moved from place to place, not necessarily of their own doing. Have any of us ever felt isolated from family or society for being different? Who has not had feelings of not belonging? So what reasons can any of you think of for exile today, whether something we do or something we have experienced? I would suggest social status, gender, sexual orientation, marital status, race, language, culture. Someone said this morning, education, economics. I mean, there's multiple things that we do to create who the other is. Today, many, as I said, many faith communities. unchained from what binds us. And lastly, in the world of exile, be thankful. Now that sounds like a strange suggestion, but Jesus was known to be a boundary crosser, touching and communing with the marginalized, the exiled. Note that in this story, there's no quiz or requirement, there's no condition or measure of worthiness to get on, to be healed, to be granted healing. The former lepers were clearly excited to go get their clearance from the priests and get on with living. Now, not that the other lepers did anything horrible. I wonder if we are sometimes so eager to get on with life that we fail to recognize from whom all things come. The Samaritan was the only one to turn and give praise and thanks to God. In Jesus, he experienced not only physical healing, but liberation, wholeness, freedom from alienation and separation, and now could live universal inclusion with others. And he was grateful. Henry Ward Beecher, who now I have learned has Guilford connections. He's a 19th century American preacher, and he used this image to describe what it means to live a life of gratitude. Suppose someone gave you a dish of sand, and in that sand is mixed iron filings. So you try to see them with your eyes, and you can't see them. You put your fingers through the sand, and you can't seem to find where those little itty-bitty filings are. You have an aha moment, and you grab a little magnet. And the magnet then is swept through the sand and comes up with all sorts of iron filings. Pastor Beecher says that the ungrateful person is like our hands combing through the sand. Such a person finds nothing to be grateful for. The grateful person, on the other hand, is like the magnet sweeping through the sand. That person finds hundreds of things to be thankful for. So when we talk about Eucharist, you know the translation for Eucharist is Thanksgiving. As we come forward to receive the body of Christ, may we be freed from our exile, whatever that is. May God's grace assist us to rise above and cross boundaries of division. May we see through and beyond the Holy Sacrament into the eyes of the other and know belonging. Belonging which surpasses all our understanding.
place in our care. We pray for the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
Remembering those who are vulnerable and defenseless, let us pray for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
In our cycles of prayer, we pray for the clergy and people of St. John's Vernon, St. Paul's Wallingford, St. John's Washington, and the Anglican Church of Southern Africa, as we pray for the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For our presiding Bishop Michael, our Bishops Ian and Laura, our Bishop-elect Jeffrey, Reverend Kathy, and all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in this church.
For all victims of violence, for all who are contending with COVID-19 disease, and for all facing financial hardship, for the special needs and concerns of this congregation, including all those commended to the prayers of the parish. Richard M., Cynthia D., Jewel, Kasha, Jennifer Spine, Patty Ann, Ed Courtney, Suzanne, Bill and Family, Sarah L., Maxim, Greg, Megan, Keith, Alejandra, Cameron, Brianna, Roger, and Denise. Please also keep in your prayers Janice, Bill C., Sandy and Lee, Ted and Carolyn, Betty, Wick and Barb, Russ and Joan, Dave and Winnie and their families, Kevin L., Brenny, Jean W., Molly and Babs, Mrs. Lipinski's daughter, Jim, Megan, Brett, Kelly, Charlie, Bill and family, Dolores, Paul, Carissa, Steve, Clarice, Claire, Mary, Tommy, Jean, Rachel, and Mark, and for those on your hearts. Hear us, Lord.
Where's this is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life, for this beautiful October day. We will exalt you, O God, our King. They may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Tess, Kathy, Shelley, Bill, Jean. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them. Put their trust in you.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm Susan Leonard. See your word. I'm copying this morning to welcome Kathy, who's traveled from Madison all the way to Guilford. Our churches used to be combined, I understand. And anyway, Kathy lives in Madison, and we're happy to have her here today. Thank you for that wonderful sermon. I love the imagery. I'll never look at a dish of Sam in the same way again. Okay, I'd like to just draw your attention to some of our upcoming announcements here. And we have morning prayer inside, and we would like to welcome people to come to the parish hall. We sit far enough apart that and there's air and everything, so I hope people who don't come to this service will feel free to come to the 9 o'clock in the future. There was no Sunday school today, sort of a surprise to some of us, but I guess we have to learn the drill. So thank you to the young people who are patiently sitting with us in church, and we are happy to have you. There's coffee hour following the service in the parish hall. Coming up, we have Bible study on Zoom with our own Cecilia Parker. That will be every Thursday at 9:30 a.m. ECW will be meeting at the Maritime Grill on Thursday at noon. Contact Diane Link. And the other choir rehearsal Thursday, and then there were just a couple of us here for the noon music meditation on Friday. The doors of the church were open. It looked great. People out on the green could hear the organ music, but we want people to come in and sit in here and just enjoy the organ music for half an hour. Mark played beautifully, as always, and it was a very peaceful, nice half hour. So feel free to bring your lunch or just to sit with us at that time. Once again, we really need people to participate in the food bank. We're going to start, the outreach committee has decided to start bringing up baskets of food as we used to do, and so we're going to have things to put in those baskets. So there's a list of items that the food bank is looking for. There's still some tickets available for the celebration of ordination of the Reverend Jeffrey William Mello on Saturday. What else? Let's see. Something really important. Well, I have an ask. I would just like to ask if there are any recovering school teachers in the crowd who really, really miss doing bulletin boards. Because if you go into the parish hall, there are lots of bulletin boards, and they're all just these blank slates, you know. And I am a recovering school teacher, but I never was that great at bulletin boards. But I know some of you out there, I'll get the paper, I'll get the little borders and things, but just, or, you know, whatever you think would look good on those bulletins, they're blank, and it doesn't look so good in there right now. So I think that's it. Any other questions? Okay.
Are there birthdays or anniversaries among us? I understand this week is birthdays for Kasha and Jean. So we'll pray for them and wish them a happy birthday. Let us walk in love as Christ loves us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks. All holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Bring us into into the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons, that with all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
And now let us now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Lord Jesus, I cannot now worship you at the altar of the church in the sacrament of your body and blood. Yet in spirit, I would join myself with all those who in your holy church offer you the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Visit me, I pray, with your mercy, pardon, and blessing. And fill me with faith and love and repentance, and so strengthen and sustain me by your grace, that I may with pure heart and mind follow you, the only God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
remiss if I didn't say that Catherine Feinberg would like to teach a few people how to do altar guild after this service. She won't be here next week, and so if we want to have an altar guild next week, we need a couple of volunteers to come and let her teach us. And I apologize for not saying that during the announcement.